wife or making racist comments. Now, with that being said, they were kids when they made these comments. You can go back to anyone's Twitter when they are 17 and 18 years old, and you can find things that they would take back. They're different people. These guys are 24 and 25 years old, and they are different people than they were 17 and 18. It's different if you're like 50 and 60. Those aren't different people. But 17 and 18, when you're still trying to figure out who exactly you are as a person, forget about what you want to do with your life. That's probably all set. But as a person, your values, what you find funny, what you find acceptable, that changes over time. I understand why people got upset over Hader, Turner, and Newcomb. And there's a certain member of the WHPC staff that really needs to watch his back with this. I'm not going to say who it is.
Mm-hmm.
I will say, though, I did speak to this person recently, and I did say to him, watch out, because I don't want anything to happen to you. But, Eric, you hit on it. It's the pros and cons of Twitter. The pro is I can put out my opinion in the world. The con is there's no filter. If I wanted to tweet out something with, God forbid, the N-word, you know, I may think that's funny, but to someone else, it could be wildly offensive, and that could sink my chances at a future job. It's no secret that I'm looking for a job. If I tweet out something with the N-word, that hurts my chances. It's horrible.
It's just such a tricky situation. I got into a conversation with somebody on the homestretch yesterday, and we came to the point of, if these guys were nobodies, if these guys were the 40th man on the roster, if this guy was the 53rd member of the football roster, they'd be gone. But being that these guys are big names, you know, Trey Turner's a big name.
Josh Hader was an all-star.
Yeah, Josh Hader's a big name. Sean Newcomb is a big name. If these guys were nobodies, they'd be gone. But because, like, actually, here's a good way to say it. If this happened to Eli Manning or Sam Darnold, you know, we would be having a much different reaction because that's our respective teams, you know?
I don't even think it's that, though. Like, we're all getting emotional over these guys, and I don't care about their teams. If they go 162-0, fantastic. If they go 0-162, fantastic. I don't care. I don't think that's the crux of the issue. You brought up a good point of the 53rd guy on the roster, the 40th guy on the roster, however you want to look at it. When IKN and Polly punched out Geno Smith, and Polly was immediately released, Todd Bowles had a press conference and said it doesn't matter if you're the star on the team or the lowest guy on the totem pole, you know, we're going to cut you if you do something like that. And I was listening to Joe and Evan because they were on in place of Mike that day, and Joe brought up the point, well, wait a minute, if that was Darrell Revis, do you really think that that would happen? So it's tough. I think it depends. I mean, the Blue Jays rid themselves of a very good player, and you can't tell me that they got equal value for him.
No, of course not. Ozuna is a top-tier talent.
Roberto Ozuna is one of the best closers in all of baseball. You can't tell me that they got equal value for him. This wasn't a baseball trade. This was a, we are washing our hands clean of this guy, and the Astros are giving him a second chance.
We're cleaning up our image, is what you're saying.
Yeah, everyone makes mistakes. Some people's mistakes are different than others. Some are more forgivable than others. If you shoot someone and that's a mistake, that's pretty unforgivable. A racist tweet when you're 17 or 18 years old, I would forgive someone like that. I personally would. That's just me. You're listening to Beyond the Game on the Voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHPC. We are live twice a week, Tuesdays at 5 p.m. and Fridays at 3 p.m. I am Jacob Volk, sitting across from me, Eric Fischetti and Matt Charkowick. Number to call if you have something on your mind is 516-572-7440. Also, we're giving away a pair of tickets to the Long Island Duck game on Sunday, August 12th at 5.05 p.m. If you want those tickets, you can call that number. We're going to be on for an extra hour today for extended coverage of the MLB trade deadline. Again, big thanks to the program director, Sean, and Teddy Savalas, the host of The Soul of Halas, for letting us do that. Soul of Halas will be on in its regular time next week. In about 9 minutes, we'll be interviewing Tim Healy, Newsday's New York Met beat writer. But we've got a couple more trades that we can hit on here. The Twins traded Zach Duke and $75,000 to the Mariners for Chase DeJong and Ryan Costello. Actually, I think it's DeJong. Chase DeJong and Ryan Costello.
Oh, what, it's the same thing as the Cardinals, Paul DeJong?
Yeah, that's what it is.
Okay.
This year, Duke's 3-4 with a 3.62 ERA. And according to MLB.com, DeJong was Seattle's 28th best prospect. What do you think won the trade?
Duke's got to be up there in age. I remember when he was on Pittsburgh, and he was really, really good.
Me too.
Look, I will say this. Irregardless of the age, Duke has mileage on him. He's had, you know, experience with him, and I speak very highly of veteran presence and experience. I think that
really goes...
Yeah, but, you know, Matt didn't know that. But
I think everyone knows.
Well, I mean, it's obvious. But I think the Mariners got a very good guy in Zach Duke. Not only are they going to help out the bullpen, they're clearly in a race also. They're in a playoff race. They're possibly going to be playing the Yankees in the wild card. But you know what? It's
James Paxton could be trouble for him. He pitched seven innings of very good baseball last night.
And Luis Severino's been off lately.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
I'm concerned. I'm not going to lie to you.
That's pretty scary.
There's a part of me that's concerned over it. The sensible part of my brain wants to say that this is baseball. That happens. Pitchers go into slumps. But the panicky side of my brain wants to say, no, the Yankees needed to trade for Blake Snell or Jacob DeGrom. They needed to give up the farm for him. But the sensible part of my brain outweighs the panicky part. In answer to your question, Eric, Zach Duke is 35 years old.
I thought he was older.
Nope, 35.
Really? Wow, I thought he was at least 37. Okay, wow. But look, it just falls into my point. He's been in the league for a while. He has experience, and the Mariners got a very good piece. I would say the Mariners won this deal. Because, again, they're in the wild card race right now. They're not catching the Astros. It's just not happening. I think the logical part of everyone's brain right now is saying that the Houston Astros are winning the AL West. And the Mariners, while they are close behind, that's just true, they're just not going to overtake the Astros.
No, there's no question about that. The Astros are winning the AL West. The Mariners are gearing up to face the Yankees in the wild card. And if Paxton or King Felix, whoever starts that game, will probably be Paxton, gets knocked out, they want to reinforce the bullpen, and adding a lefty to face the lefties that the Yankees have, cough, cough, Greg Bird, is always a good idea. They gave up a nothing guy in Chase DeJong. He's a nothing. Costello's a nothing. I love this trade for the Mariners. They win it easily. The Reds traded Adam Duvall to the Braves for Lucas Sims, Preston Tucker, and Matt Whistler. This year, Duvall's hitting .205 with 15 home runs and 61 RBIs. Sims has only pitched in 6 games. Tucker's hitting .256 with 4 home runs and 22 RBIs. And Whistler's only pitched in 7 games. Who do you think won the trade?
Would you consider Adam Duvall boom or bust kind of player? Because by the stats, that's what it's kind of showing me. He's got, you know, good home run count, but a low average to me.
All right. Well, a .205 average is horrible. There's no excuse to that. I don't care if you hit 80 home runs. There's no excuse for a .205 average. Adam Duvall, 2 years ago, he was an all-star. He looked like the next Ken Griffey Jr., basically.
Oh, Reds Ken Griffey Jr.? Okay.
Yeah. He was a fantastic player. I'll read you his stats. I have him right here. .241, 33 home runs, 103 RBIs in his all-star year. Then in 2017, .249, 31 home runs, 99 RBIs. Yes, you'd like the average to be higher, but when you're hitting 31 home runs, minimum, you can hit .240.
So this is just an off year for him right now.
This is an off year for him. Sims and Whistler also did not reach that elite level that everyone thought they would. Preston Tucker has no spot on the Braves. This is a change of scenery trade. You take my guy who's struggling and try to turn him around, and I'll take these three highly projectable guys. I'll reinforce my rotation that needs it in Sims and Whistler. The Reds' rotation is garbage. They could use Sims and Whistler if they turn into something. Preston Tucker replaces Duvall in the outfield. I like this trade for both teams. It's a change of scenery trade. There's no way to properly evaluate it now. Wait a few years and then see who really won it. Because again, This is a change of scenery trade. The Angels traded Ian Kinsler and $1.83 million to the Red Sox for Ty Buttrey and Williams Jerez this year. Kinsler's hitting .239 with 13 home runs and 32 RBIs. And according to MLB.com, Buttrey and Jerez were Boston's 19th and 23rd best prospects, respectively. Who do you think won the trade?
I think the Sox think that Pedroia is going to be out longer than they thought.
Definitely.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm not really the biggest fan of Ian Kinsler. I don't love him. I don't hate him either. This is basically...
I like Kinsler a lot. I'll be honest with you.
To me,
he's having a horrible year.
To me, what this says, I think it's also a change of scenery, if you ask me. He's getting thrown into the fire in Boston. They're leading the division. They're gearing up for a massive playoff race. They're gearing up for a pretty good playoff, probably. But you know what? I think this is the gap for when Pedroia comes back.
Yeah, definitely.
I don't really see much looking into it. I think the stats are, you know, okay, like almost 240, 13 home runs. And, you know, these are the kind of stats that maybe you would have wanted Duvall to have. Because,
yeah,
you know,
definitely.
Almost similar in home runs, but just really big gap in just the batting percentage. But you know what? I don't hate this trade for the Red Sox. I don't hate it. They just are worried about Dustin Pedroia to me.
Yeah, I know why the Red Sox did it. It's because of Pedroia, and they need someone to bridge that gap. With that being said, though, I love this trade for the Angels. Kinsler did nothing for them, and they got a very intriguing player in Ty Buttrey, who can come up now and contribute for them. He has hit 101 miles an hour on his fastball in the Arizona Fall League.
Is he a starter?
No, he's a reliever.
Oh, okay. Well,
so... like I said before, there's a role for that.
The guy on the White Sox that was included in the Chris Sale deal, I think his name was Michael Kopech.
Yes.
He hit 104, 105, whatever it was. I'm kind of worried about that because if you keep throwing that hard unless you're converted to a reliever, that can throw your arm out.
Oh, definitely.
Absolutely.
That's why guys like Chapman and Hicks are now in the bullpen. I'm talking about Jordan Hicks,
yeah,
not Aaron Hicks.
Although we can hit 105 from center field.
Oh, my goodness gracious. Well, how about Stanton? Have you seen his exit velocity? 120 sometimes.
I am not. Look, I am so satisfied with Giancarlo Stanton. I just, look.
Everyone is.
It's good to be a Yankee fan. Let's just
very
say
very good. All right, so you hear this sound? That's
wow.
Me crumpling
one page.
Up the one page.
Almost there.
You're almost there. We've got 1.5 pages left of MLB trades to go through. We got to take a quick break. Don't go anywhere because we'll have an exclusive interview coming up next with Tim Healy. He's Newsday's New York Met beat writer. It's coming up next on Beyond the Game on the voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHPC.
Those serving in our military, they're the difference makers. Separated from family, enduring hardships far from home, sacrificing for their country while serving in a different country. Well, for those of us who support our armed forces through the USO, we get to make a difference too. Through the USO, we get to be the force that delivers the phone call between spouse and deployed service member. The force that brings newborn and new parent together through a delivery room video chat. And the force that makes sure our military serving 7,000 miles away gets to watch the big game from a USO center. We get to be the force behind the forces, connecting them to every comfort of family, home, and country possible. It's a good feeling to make a difference. Visit uso.org/force to learn how you can be the force behind the forces.
Alexa, can you please do my food shopping today?
Food shopping today added to your shopping list.
Alexa, can you do my math homework for me?
I'm not sure.
Alexa, play WHPC.
Play WHPC.
You can now listen to the voice of Nassau Community College on your Amazon Echo.
Simply say, Alexa, play WHPC.
I am already playing WHPC.
Sorry. So go ahead and buy a silicone steamer in the shape of a faceless melting pig.
Buy a silicone steamer in the shape of a faceless melting pig.
Yeah, that exists. And while you shop, play WHPC.
or buy a headband with a mullet hair attached to it.
I refuse to buy a headband with mullet hair attached to it.
Yeah, that exists too. Not sure why. But when you buy it, you can play WHPC.
So play WHPC on your Amazon device today.
And thanks for listening to 90.3.